Good afternoon, everyone. Hello. I'm Chris Burns, and I am a member of the Library Lecture Series, and I'd like to welcome each and every one of you to the third Earth Day program that has been hosted by the C. Smith Reynolds Library. This year, our topic is Campus as a Classroom, and I'd like to turn over our panel discussion to Dee Dee Johnston, who is the Director of Sustainability here at Wake Forest. So without further ado, Dee Dee, it's all yours.
Great, thanks Chris. Happy Earth Day, everyone. Hopefully you know it's the 40th anniversary of Earth Day, and we're so pleased to be able to celebrate it on campus this day with the theme of kind of campus and earth and connecting with place. And I think you're really gonna enjoy hearing from these four faculty members on how they are observing campus and bringing a sense of place to students and to their colleagues. You may be familiar with some of these folks, but I'll just introduce them since we have them here. Drs. Rowan, Dr. Whithouse, Brown, and Wakield, and from four different departments. And so hopefully you'll get a broad idea from the four of these faculty members on the ways that different departments and disciplines can use the campus as a classroom. So these are the things that we've asked them to talk about, and we'll see how well they do at the end of this, if they even remember. They're going to let us know the spaces that each of them have worked with, some for teaching and some for research, why they chose to take a class or research outside instead of keeping it within the confines of four walls, what type of research or teaching they've done on the campus and with respect to the landscape, and why this choice was particularly effective for them or for the learning outcomes for their students, and what advice they might give to any of you on how to take teaching and learning outside of the classroom and onto the campus. Fair enough? You remember that? So without further ado,
yeah.
I'm going to pull up the email where I asked you to do that.
I'm sure it was on there.
Yeah, Dr. Brown is going to get us started off with a conversation about the Rinalda Estate and the areas surrounding campus.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dee Dee. Yes, I should read my emails fully beforehand. So, but I will talk at least on some of those points. And I'm a biology professor and head of the environmental program, so of course we have lots of opportunities to work outside and incorporate our classes into the not only the campus proper, but the broader campus that was the former Rinalda Estate. And then, of course, we go a little bit beyond that too, so I kind of chose this picture to kind of home in on campus, and then going off campus a little bit more, we do bring classes to, most of the time, fairly close places, maybe between here and Pilot Mountain, and we actually have a fair number of research sites that we do for research programs between here and Pilot Mountain, and I'm also personally attached to the Earth because, wrong way there. Let's see, right there on Saratown Mountain, I own about 50 acres right across from Pilot, so I go up there all the time and play with my rattlesnakes and endangered species and hike around there quite a bit. So we have kind of the immediate campus, and then we this is where we're going to spend 90% of our time. Most of our student effort is going to be here, but then we go beyond, maybe even to the Blue Ridge. Let's get this right here. The Blue Ridge and the Appalachians, and then onward to other places that are much farther afield, Peru, Galapagos. But most of our time is here, so we're really spending most of our lives here, and most of our academic is here as well. So part of this is the Rinalda Estate, and as you're all aware, this campus itself was built on the back end of the Rinalda Estate, and I brought a little historical artifact that I'll pass around here, which is the plot plan for the Rinalda Estate in 1925, if I have this correct way here. It shows all the farms that were assembled here, and the Reynolds have a very interesting history, as most wealthy families do, and Mrs. Reynolds especially was interested in I think she was quite a conservationist for her day, very much interested in having a model farm, good land management. She had the money to do it, and they assembled this. And also, if you wanted to be anybody in those days, if you wanted to compete with the Vanderbilts or the Dukes, you had to have at least 1,000 acres. So they assembled 1,015 acres from mostly rundown farms, and then assembled the campus here. And we have that kind of a, you can pass that around if you want. kind of environmental history, at least from 1925, from that estate. And we actually use that quite a bit because some of our research involves environmental history. We're looking at tree types, usage of those. We take the students out, tell them about ecological succession, and we want to be able to say, oh, this is how old this area is. So, for instance, you know, we want to say, oh, in 1925, this area was pastureland. We can actually have some good documentation to prove this. So we do a number of studies here. This one, we do some studies on ecological succession from anything, bring students out, look at soil types, look at how the land is changing from birth of small trees from acorns up to larger ones. We also do some more professional type research, so we've actually put lots of little trackers in each acorn, look to see how far they're dispersed by squirrels, can recover those, and have done that type of research on campus as well. We do have some pretty old trees on campus, so part of our interest is a broader study on how biodiversity changes with forest age. And most of this is local. We've got quite a bit in the Appalachians, and we have a parallel project down in Peru as well. But here on campus, we actually have some of the oldest, largest trees in Forsyth County. So you don't know where they are so much. And we have some other ones. The best documented ones are in Bethabara. So we have little patches of very old forest. For instance, where they're putting in the new Welcome Center, that little forest in front of there, not the part that's kind of down the hill, we know that some of that forest is at least 140, 150 years old from when they tore the trees down. We took some slices of them and did some dendrochronology of them. So we know that those are old, and we think actually that forest there, since that's a later successional stage, it probably predates the Civil War. If you go on the back end of campus, go around Silas Creek, follow that all the way back to Old Town Country Club, we have probably some of the largest trees on campus, just a few of them, but they almost certainly date to 200, 250 years old. So we are doing some research on how biodiversity, especially with invertebrates, changes with forest type. We involve a lot of students, bring them out. They get pretty excited about going out to different places and being able to check traps and things like that. One of our longer term studies here was on southern flying squirrels, which are very common on campus, probably one of the most common small mammals on campus. But they're nocturnal, pretty cryptic, you don't see them very often. And we've been doing a number of studies, genetic studies on those here on campus and elsewhere, looking at, say, kinship when you get into next boxes, when they aggregate, how close of family relationships are they? Are they kind of looking out for one another because they're kin with them or not? And one of our kind of interesting, we think, outcomes of that study on a broader one is that these southern flying squirrels, which are very widespread now through the entire eastern U.S., actually have very, very little genetic diversity. They went through a genetic bottleneck probably during the last Pleistocene when they were pushed down to a very small refugia. Now have expanded out with the retreat of the ice ages, but they actually don't have much genetic diversity at all. So we can do some dendrochronology studies and do some ring counts on these. As I said, at least on campus, we know that some of the trees we can document are at least 150 years old. We can use this type of map to say, oh, in 1925, we know this area was forested, and be able to come up with some other ages for different plots on campus. One of the studies that we're doing here in Peru, the Appalachians, centers on flightless beetles, kind of lowly organisms, not quite as charismatic as southern flying squirrels, but we like them, and actually we just kind of backed into them. We didn't really know a whole lot about flightless beetles. But we have probably about, right now, roughly about 500 pitfall traps set out for these in different forest areas throughout the Carolinas, the Appalachians. And then we just have another student who spent a year in Peru, and she's going back down this summer doing transects along the Peruvian area. So we have a connection to campus and kind of a connection to beyond as well. And we use these things as indicators of biodiversity and can go down to the tropics and say, oh, we found this type of a flightless beetle here. It's only found in undisturbed areas. So we can say pretty authoritatively that this piece of jungle was probably never colonized within the last 200 years or so. And sometimes the jungle growth being so rapid, it's hard to say that. Okay, so we've got lots of different tree types here. Interesting thing about Forsyth County is we have some very good historical records, not only from the Reynolds Estate, but broader, primarily because of our Moravian heritage. So the Moravians hired Christian Reuter back in 1762 to do a complete survey of Forsyth County, the Walkout Tract. Spent 2 years doing it. He was trained. He was good. One of the first really complete surveys of the non-coastal area of the U.S., pre-colonial or pre-revolutionary. And one of the interesting things to us, we went back and redocumented what tree types are here. Every tree species that was found in 1762 is still here in Forsyth County. So that kind of shocked us that despite the massive land clearing, land disturbance, where virtually everything in this county, with a few little exceptions, has been cut or cleared, we didn't lose too much tree diversity. We lost some other things, certainly, but not trees. Okay, we use broader campus for a number of things here, aquatics surveys. We do insect biology here. We've done bat work. We have bird studies going on now. In fact, as I was just looking out my window, I was watching some birds fly into two different feeders, one of which has seeds that are covered with capsaicin, kind of red pepper dust, basically, versus those that don't. And we want to see if birds can preferentially detect capsaicin or not, which kind of links to how good their sensory perception is in some areas. So it's got some broader questions to it. Okay, of course, we have Lake Catherine, or its remnants. Lake Catherine was formed about 1913, 1915, big open water lake, and now has, of course, as you all of us are well aware, has filled up pretty rapidly here with silt, much of that from the building of the Wake Forest campus before they put in sediment controls. But it's a naturally kind of high erosion area anyway, and in fact, when the Reynolds first built that lake, they put in some silt-catching dams because they wanted to try to prevent the silt from coming in. It wasn't very effective, but they did do that. We do have done a number of studies on Lake Catherine. None of those published, but we use them a lot for aquatic ecology, look to see what fish changes have occurred. We now have about a 30-year record of that. And water quality. Water quality is actually surprisingly good until it rains. And then you get all sorts of nasty things in there from a typical urban environment, from, you know, dog poop to a lot of heavy metals from cadmium especially, which you get from tire wear. And it's also, there were a lot of industrial processes upstream that put in a lot of heavy metals in there. So actually the sediment waste in there, the Reynolds Foundations looked into dredging that at one time, but we advised them, not officially, but from our studies, we think that much of that would have to be considered as toxic waste and would be exorbitantly expensive to take out of there. And it's probably better just locked in place. Mm-hmm. And we looked at a number of critters there. We did do a study on this guy, actually way back. A graduate student named John Foyle did some work on snapping turtles and used Lake Catherine as one of his sites. And still go down there now, there's still a fair number of snapping turtles, not nearly as many as there used to be, but one of them likes to hang up near the walkway there, and if you throw something off in midsummer and let it kind of hit the water, you'll often see him kind of come out and try to get them, and they are fairly ferocious at times, and this guy was interesting because he was a hemophiliac, and he was doing all this work on these animals that could be, yeah. And I don't know, but kind of a sad story because he died of AIDS about 7-8 years later because it was before they had knew much about AIDS, and he and his brother both died from injection of contaminated clotting factors. So very, very sad, but he worked on those. This area, of course, you're probably familiar with in the waterfalls, but if you look a little bit downstream, maybe in here a little bit more, you'll notice there's a second dam down there. Now it is eroded beyond that. That area was built as a reflecting pool and actually has a cement base to it. So they used to use that for aesthetics, and among the African-American employees of the Rinalda House, they had a series of houses, actually right where Silas Creek comes into campus now. They're actually on this map called Five Points. And they used to do a lot of full immersion baptisms here, and everybody used to do a lot of picnicking in that area. So it's a interesting spot there, and good aeration from the water there, so we often do some studies for invertebrates right below that, and do some comparisons of whole stream invertebrate biotic indexes, where we look from very clear water in some of the secondary streams, and then into the more turbid, kind of disturbed and polluted water of Silas Creek itself. This is over, getting kind of greater campus, Gray Lynn. Little pond in the back there, spring fed, very nice, very high water quality, has some great invertebrates in there, from water scorpions to all sorts of nice stuff in there. So we use that for a lot of classes, both for insect biology and aquatic. And I've done some studies there on marking dragonflies and damselflies, where we, not very sophisticated, but we capture them, dab them with little color-coded paint dabs, and then recapture them and see how far they've dispersed among different systems. And of course, the stream itself has contributed quite a bit to the change in the lake. We've had succession going on there even since I've been here. It used to be a much more open water lake, and now we're to the point where the former boathouse there is now pretty much landlocked. It's an environmental center from Rinalda House. We used to have, when I first came here, we had actually students who lived in there, but during spring floods, if you're here, the water will get up to there. So they get flooded out about once every 2 years or so. So it makes for a little bit of a problem. But it's changed from being a boathouse and at least rumors of scandalous stories with the Reynolds boys of goings on there to now a landlocked environmental education center. So we use campus in many ways, and you know, I think from kind of addressing some of those questions that I should have read earlier, you know, at least from my experience, and I think almost all our students, you know, you're in a dry classroom, you're showing PowerPoint after PowerPoint, it's like, oh, that's nice, you know, and I've got this. But once you take them out in the field, they remember those things, and they, you know, really brings it home to them, and especially if they're involved with research projects, whether it's smaller projects that are in the field or things that they're maybe a little bit more committed to. We do a lot of independent research studies, and I don't know, I probably have had, 9, 10 students who have been co-authors on paper with me, so they really get excited about that as they get more and more into it. So those are the things that I think help them determine much more where their career paths are going to be and where, kind of where their love and interest is. So, okay.
Hi, so I'm going to talk a little bit about Campus Garden. My name is Jamin Rowan, and I teach in the English department. And specifically, I teach a freshman writing seminar called You Are What You Eat. And the writing seminar focuses on current conversations about food in our culture. And so all their readings and writing assignments have to do with some of those conversations that are happening in those conversations. I want to actually tell a little bit about the history of how the garden got started, because I think I'm really most proud of this fact of how it got started. So first of all, the campus garden is behind the home at 1141 Polo Road. And I'm assuming most people don't know exactly where that is. But if you know where freshman parking is, the campus garden shares the bottom gate with freshman parking, or if you were to take that path that walks through the Scales parking lot and past Rinalda Park on the left, Sockerfield on the right, where that path dumps you right behind that house is where the garden's at. And so this is what it used to look like last summer. We have now taken that gate that's on the side and swung it out so that now the garden goes all the way down to where that freshman parking gate is. And right now we're in the process of killing this grass in order to make it plantable for the future. So those are some of the details about where it is. But how it got started was last year when I taught this section. I always, at the end of the class, assign them to do something as a project, most often a group project, where they take the things that we've been talking about and the things they've been writing about, the kind of knowledge they've generated in their research papers and other papers, and try to do something with it. Try to either share it with a broader community or make some kind of change on campus. And so Whitney and Alex were two lone students who had done research on what other universities were doing in their food chain to change the way that students on campus eat. And they realized that several other universities had campus gardens. And they thought, well, this would be great. You know, Wake Forest needs a campus garden. So they started meeting with people. They're the ones that contacted people on and off campus as a way to see how feasible this would be and to get some feedback from people. And you know, they talked with a number of people, and eventually they had a meeting with Jim Coffey, who said, well, actually, you know, a biology professor just got in touch with me who said that she needs land for her tomatoes, that she's doing research on tomatoes. So Dr. Gloria Madej, some of you may know, and these students and I kind of paired up and joined forces, and people were just amazingly, on campus, people were amazingly receptive. So we got this garden, you know, kind of from inception of idea to like plant in the ground was only, I think, a couple of months, which was amazing, you know, for how quickly that happened. So last summer, we broke ground on a pilot garden, and Dr. Madej had to have her tomatoes in, so I think that was the thing that was driving sped it up. And so half of the garden was her research tomatoes, and then the other half we planted last summer with about 60 to 70 varieties of heirloom tomatoes, and we also had some other things in there, some squash and beans and all sorts of other stuff. So this has become a really vibrant space. You know, it serves several different functions, and I'm going to talk about some of those functions. You know, there's obviously it's a research garden. So Dr. Madej still does her research tomatoes there. Those will go in here in the next month or so, so really important for her. It also serves as a really nice outdoor classroom for a variety of different classes. Right now, Pat Lord, who's teaching a biology 101 for non-medical school people, whatever that is. I didn't know that they existed. Everybody goes to medical school. She decided, well, wouldn't this be great to teach biology through food? And so two of her four lab sections, and I know the two that weren't the garden lab sections are not happy about this, but two of her four lab sections, their lab was the garden stuff. So they had their own plots that they have been taken care of, and I'm not sure exactly the nature of all what they're looking for, but I knew they did stuff with genetics as a way to teach genetics. They also have got composting bins set up, and they're doing experiments with composting and different ways that you might go about composting. So it's a great classroom space for that kind of situation. You know, I certainly use it in my class as well. My class will be there on Friday. So I think it can serve a variety of different kinds of classes, not just the sciences or English people, but a variety of places. So we certainly encourage that. It's also great for non-class but campus organization type group. So this group actually is a SPARC group, and I should have looked. Who knows what SPARC stands for? I'll pretend this is a quiz. it's a pre-semester orientation where students are really involved in community service and service learning. They come to campus a few days before. I think it's primarily for freshmen or exclusively for freshmen. They come and they get a little taste of different opportunities for doing service, community service on campus. So this is a group that we hosted in, I guess it would have been late August, that came to campus. That was great. We also, where does our produce go? It all goes to, with the exception of Dr. Madej's tomatoes, which don't ripen. People always ask me what her experiment is, and she's told me 1,000 times, and I wish I could tell you what she's investigating. But they don't ripen. The tomatoes don't ripen, so I know they're not great for edibility. But the majority, all of our edible produce goes to Campus Kitchen. So this has been a great partner for us. You know, in the past at least, certainly when they were over in the cafeteria that was where the business people, I can't remember the name of that, you know, they had very little access to fresh produce. They have more now that they are actually located in at the pit. but they were using all canned vegetables really for their stuff. So this was great for them. They use the produce incorporated into their cooking, and then also just give the produce, if they don't cook it, straight to some of the communities that they service. So that's another opportunity. Here are my kids, two of my four kids. And it's been great. You know, it's just a larger, it's a great space for a larger community where faculty, students, kids, we even have some neighbors that are showing up that just became really interested in gardening. And so it's a great community spot at a place like Wake Forest that really puts a lot of value upon community. This has been a really pleasant function, and the students have especially have really gotten into it, and they've formed a group of the course students have formed a group called CROP, which stands for Campus Raised Organic Produce, and so they're trying to raise awareness in other areas and trying to recruit people, and so the campus garden hosts, or they're in charge of the non-research, non-classroom type stuff that grows there, and so it's really exciting to see that community form of these students who've come together. And then certainly for teaching purposes, we haven't done this as much this semester, though we hope to do so in the summer and into the fall. Use the garden as a community outreach. So Dr. Madej in particular has gone to a couple, I think two or three community schools, local schools. She went to an elementary school and I think a junior high. Using the great range of tomatoes that we grew there to talk to students about the biological variety and what tomatoes can look like and what they can taste like. I don't know if anybody's been watching Jamie Oliver's Food Revolution, but you know, one of the most stunning moments of that is when students in the classroom had no clue what a potato or a tomato was. Mm-hmm. And so not only are we showing them what tomatoes are, but you know, the great range of what tomatoes can look like. I think that's the end of me. So Campus Garden is a great space, and if anybody's interested, I'll use this plug. You know, let me know, and I'll be happy to put you on the listserv. We have a listserv of about, I think, 100 or so people, but we certainly don't get that many people out on a regular basis. But it's a great opportunity to get to know other people, to get your hands dirty, and to do a lot of good. And we right now we're gardening on Wednesdays from 4 to 6 and Fridays from 3 to 5. So come out and join us.
Great. Switch media, I have to hold my breath that it all goes well, so it worked. my name's Emily Wakefield, and I teach in the history department, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about two classes that I teach that use parts of campus as a living laboratory. My specialty is Latin America, so clearly Latin America isn't on campus. So in those classes, it's a bit more of a challenge, but this is my third year here, and since I've been here, I've developed two classes in part to, I think, respond to some of the need and desire by students to think more carefully about their place in the world as it connects to the landscape in which they live. And so I teach a freshman seminar that's entitled The Dirt on Development. And it's How to Solve the World's Problems is the byline that goes along with it. What I've done is essentially take a list of some of my favorite books and spin it into a class. And what these books all have in common are that individual people have tried to solve some problem within their community, and they've gone about doing it in different ways. So we read Muhammad Yunus's book about microfinance, for example, and we read about Paul Farmer's work in Haiti and with healthcare as a human right in Haiti in particular. We also read Wangari Maathai, who won the Nobel Peace Prize. She's a Kenyan woman for planting trees across Kenya, and a number of other articles, but those are a couple examples. And the idea behind the class is to have students look critically about what change makers look like and how they affect positive change in their own communities. And then the long-term goal of the class is students have their own
research project, and it's a free choice assignment in the sense that they can pick whatever topic they're interested in doing, as long as it meets three criteria. The first one is it has to be in good taste. The second one, it has to, it can't be geared for profit. It can make a profit, but that can't be the sole intention of their solution to a problem. And then the third part is that it actually identifies and articulates a problem and proposes some action that solves it. Awareness itself or education itself alone isn't a solution, but it can be part of their solution, but it needs to have a concrete base to it. And what's been interesting, I've now taught the class two times, and what's been interesting is how many of the students, I would say three quarters of them, pick campus in order to solve a problem. And so they see this lesson that when you are part of a community and you see yourself as part of that, and that change is coming from within, that it's better received and the solutions are more appropriate. I think it's also shaped by the fact they're freshmen, they're in their first semester, and they're living in the dorms for the first time. And so they're in a completely new place, and it's very meaningful to them. And so a lot of the solutions come out of that living experience. Which has been neat to watch. The dorms are a very foreign space to me. I'm not quite sure all of what goes on in there, but some of the interesting projects that have come out have reacted to readings that we've had, and I'll give you a couple examples. There was a delightful student from New Jersey who explained the fact that she went to Costco every week and bought a flat of bottled water and, you know, drank water throughout the day, and at the end of the day, she had all these plastic water bottles, and it wasn't until she got here that she realized, oh, these are things that I need to take care of, you know. And so her proposal was to provide filtered water in the dorms and give all freshmen a Nalgene bottle when they enrolled and have that be sort of a symbol. So that was one that was very it affected her very well. The student from Oregon who was in the class was sort of appalled from the very beginning, and it had a very different project. So it gives them a set of criteria to which they can talk to each other and think about these problems. Another project, so in the second year, this year, this fall, DD came and presented to the class, and they were very impressed with the sustainability efforts, and two of the students have designed projects that hopefully will happen on campus. I hope they've applied to be interns with you. I hope that happens. We'll see. And one of them was a composting or expanding a compost project that hopefully would have some relationship to the campus garden. And then the second one was a getting rid of paper towels in freshman dorms. And so this student observed every day when he went into the bathroom overflowing paper towels on the floor and that as kind of a problem. And so what he did was research hand dryers and put together several phases of a project where freshman dorms, when students arrived, would start the first phase where they would get hand dryers and then gradually implementing it in all of the dorms. And he had really neat statistics on cleanliness and how that actually improves it and the effectiveness and the cost over the long term of the hand dryers. So that's one way that they look at campus, and really most of it is driven by them. It's not me leading them around. But the second course that I teach is an upper level history course for juniors and seniors, mostly take it, called Global Environmental History. And this is a course where the theme that we're looking at is how have humans both used and conserved nature over time? And part of that is how humans have shaped the environment and also how they've been shaped by it. And so we start with the Pleistocene and think about the extinction of saber-toothed cats and what that means, and we go full steam into the invention of agriculture and travel around the world twice, once in the early modern world and then again in the modern world, and then end up in the environmental movement in the United States with an article called The Death of Environmentalism in the Early 1990s. So what we do in that course is look at these texts about specific places, and it's inherently comparative. And so the main assignment for that class is a research project, which I call a place history. And students are asked to pick a place, any place, and tell us what it means. So I like to say scientists tell us how things work, and humanists tell us what they mean, right? And what they mean to different groups of people and how we construct that meaning and how that changes over time. And so I set out a set of criteria for them, but really what I asked them to do is pick a place, and all of the students picked a place that they had been, which I think is telling, and their experience of going there I think says quite a bit about place. But what I would like to incorporate, I'm teaching this course again in the fall, and what I'd like to incorporate is a tour of campus as a place from the beginning. So in describing this project to students, I sort of pushed them in the direction of looking at campus, and none of them took me up on it. And so I'm going to be a little more forceful in it this time, and we're going to do a tour and go to four different places on campus and think a little bit about what they mean. And I think part of this is thinking about a university as a microcosm of society, which I think is a really empowering way of thinking about it. So the way that I have this designed for the fall is that we'll take a tour and we'll have four stops on the tour. I might add the campus garden now that I think about it, actually, so maybe we'll do five. And student groups will be in charge of the tour, and they will introduce us to each of these places and start to contextualize it. But what I want them to do is read these places as a landscape. So look at the built environment, look at the natural environment, think about change over time, and then also, because historians look at documents, think about where you could find how other people have represented that place. So what plans could you draw up from local archives? What newspaper articles might have taken pictures or covered it in the past of time? What oral histories are there of this place and time? What folk tales or what origin stories go back to this sort of place? So peeling back the layers of time. So we'll look at the library as a house of knowledge, right? And how that's changed over time, and what it means to have a place that, that does house knowledge, and how is that place welcoming? How does that place bring us inside? How does it transform what we know or what we do? What's the particular relationship of a library? It's one of the few places where you borrow and share, right? So, you know, is it a lasting legacy of that? I'd also like to think about, have them think about Reynolds Gym and really sort of this very modern episode of sculpting our bodies indoors rather than through our labor, right? And thinking about that as fake turf, but still making it green, and a track rather than a path, and what happens behind those windows, I'm not sure. You know, sort of all of those things, and why is that a part of our culture today, and where does it come from? Was Reynolds Gym like that in the 50s? What was it like? What was there before? Sort of questions like that. Another more sort of traumatic from this picture site, thinking about the Welcome Center and the Admission Center, Bob touched on this a little bit, but the changing of the landscape, and what does it mean to destroy something in order to create something new? And what does that do to a community and a place, and how does that change the meaning? And do you ever lose the meaning from before, and who makes that decision? So these are sort of the questions that I want students to think about. And then the fourth stop on our tour will be the kind of symbolic but also spiritual center of campus, right? Most often used to represent this campus, but an interesting juxtaposition of this house of worship and a clock, right? You know, which is a very modern invention, a very recent one. And why do they come together that way? Why? What's the plan of the landscape that's around that, and who cares for it, and who makes it look that way, and what? Why the green space in the middle? So these are some of the questions that I hope to lead students on, and hopefully in the fall they'll take me up on that. And then I'll conclude with my favorite place on campus. So hidden in the corner of Olin and not Winston, Salem, yeah, is a monkey puzzle tree, which is one of two national trees of the country, the nation. It's a monkey puzzle tree, Araucaria, I think is the Latin name for it. And it is one of two national trees of Chile. And in Chile, they're 30 feet tall and have these enormous prickly fuzzballs that my cat would love on the sides. And it's almost unnoticeable, but every morning when I walk by it, I think, I wonder who put that there. Why is this here? And what's it doing? And is it happy? And those sorts of things. So that's my own little place project. So thanks.
We're loading the next bit up here. Mm-hmm. We're okay. Successful in doing this. We'll see.
Okay, and while you do that,
yeah,
I could quickly...
Yeah, we're both a little, technologically challenged. Just before you get started, I want to say I was remiss in not introducing somebody before we got started. David Davis is with us, and he's the head of landscaping services. He's the director of landscaping services. So.
Please do.
We'll get
go
a,
ahead.
Yeah, get a chance.
I purchased the tree. We put it there for, we thought it was close to some of the science buildings, and it was a kind of out of the way location that we didn't foresee any construction in the near future. And it's we really believe that we should be as diverse as we can in some of our species diversity. It's even that it brings a question up in your mind. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of people, it just makes them wonder, what is this? Where does it come from? What's it all about? So,
dozens of high schoolers were spending the week at Wake Forest University. It
we're
going to
transition now.
Drama.
Why don't we watch it since it's
Carolina's Adrian Florence explains, students aren't the only ones learning the lesson here. Adrian?
Well, there are actually about 28 students here from the eastern part of the state participating in a very special science program. And when I say a very special science program, this isn't just your average high school program. These are students from the Cherokee Nation, and they are participating in a science program that they can then take back to their communities. We're joined by Ulrike Wiephaus, who is the professor of religion here at Wake Forest University. Talk about this program and how it all came about.
Okay. Well, we are very excited and honored to have the Eastern Band of Cherokee youth with us. The program has been in place now for 3 years, and our goal is to get the students ready for college, excited and motivated to have a career that is based on the sciences. We also do medical careers, and next year we will do careers in the law.
Now, what are some of the things that they're doing here today? Because when you think of science programs, you think of kind of inside textbooks, but they're actually doing some hands-on work.
Yes. We believe that hands-on pedagogy is really the best way to go with young people, because they learn while they're doing it and remember that much better and get so much more out of the learning experience that is holistic. And what we're doing during those 3 days is that students will learn about how to survive in college, how to stay healthy, how to help other students stay healthy, how to stay motivated, how to develop their what we call student-scholar skills. With contemporary technology, our students are really becoming more like younger colleagues because they have access to information. And so our job as professors is to really make sure that they know how to use the information to the best of their own interests and the best of their community.
Yeah, and one of those ways right now is planting that Cherokee garden that they're putting in. And again, they will be here all week long, not just working out here out in the field, but they'll also be doing a lot of work in the classroom, ultimately, of course, to take that back into their communities and help their communities as well. In Winston-Salem, Adrian Flores, News 14 Carolina.
Now.
Thank you.
So I'm Ulrike Wiephaus, and I'm currently in the religion department.
Dozens of high schoolers are
at American Ethnic Studies, and it's good to be back with this program. I think it's fabulous, and I want to thank Didi for inviting all of us. And I would also like to welcome two of my collaborators, so David Davis, who is really the mastermind behind developing that marvelous space, intersection of Wingate Road and Faculty Drive. If you haven't been there, you might want to go and check it out. It's really coming along just beautifully. And David, if you want to say a few words about it.
Yeah, just real briefly. I think some of you might have been there this morning. If you weren't, I think a little history it's a really nice story. In 2008, the university put in three stormwater retention ponds to help with sedimentation, basically an area to collect the sediment and take it out every so many years. As that happened, it opened up some of the forest, and it made for a beautiful view, but it also made for a very clear view of the parking lot on the back side of Collins Hall. So with a few concerns from neighbors and whatnot, facilities decided, okay, we need to get a plan for the area. We've done something, we need to take it to the next step. So once we surveyed the area, we realized it was so genetically diverse that we felt like it was a great opportunity, especially with sort of the sustainability, the push towards sustainability, it being such a catchphrase or catchword. People were talking about native plants. So we decided we would go with an all-native garden. And just very briefly thereafter, Ulrika asked, is there a place on campus we could do some plants that were medicinally important to the Cherokee? So everything just fell in place, and I think it was almost divine that all these things fell in place. And the fact that we're trying to heal the water and heal the land by removing invasives and trying to develop and maintain good relationships with the neighbors by bringing all that together. Now we've brought people from just several different groups. We've brought people from off campus. We're just inviting a real opportunity for learning and for healing. And to me, it just makes for a great story. I really like the way the interconnectedness and sort of the circle of life that goes on with that space.
Yeah, absolutely. And so the work that you have been doing has been worked into several of my courses on American Indian and Indigenous issues. And we have another collaborator with us today, and that is Mary Scanlon. And Mary and I have been working together for many years. And maybe, Mary, you could say a few words about your contribution to our project.
Sure. I help with some of the information literacy aspects of the summer program with the Cherokee High School students. I also support a number of Dr. Vitas's classes with the same kind of information literacy stuff. We've got a couple of grants to really build up the print program here in the library to support all of her work on Indigenous peoples, both the Cherokee and some other groups around the world with a focus on medicinal plants and ethnobotany, and it's just been a real pleasure working.
Yes, and it really builds community. I think that's what we heard from all of us who are speaking today. And so what I'm interested in, because my training is in culture studies and religious studies, look at the intersection of meaning, spirituality, communities, history. So really our work is very much connected. And so what I did is then in my first year seminar called Vocation of Healing, that I had my students like you, you know, team up, or like you work in teams. I think we all do very similar pedagogies, perhaps, bringing people together and working in teams and studying the use of healing plants that are native to this area and look at how they were then used among native communities for healing up until really today. They're still being used today. And so when the Cherokee students came to the garden, then I think David, you and some other people at Landscape developed a kind of exercise for them where they had to identify traditional Cherokee healing plants, and they had to read up on them, and then they went married to your website and they got some more scientific information. And at the end of the seminar, we had a Cherokee traditional spiritual leader with us who then also would talk generally about spiritual principles behind the actual plant use, and so to bring it really all together. And we heard my dear colleague Emily Walker talk about talking to the, what was the name of that plant again?
So
the spiritual layer that connects everything is really what scholars would call animism, and that means that you understand that everything is alive and intelligent and breathing and connected. And so then that you start talking to the tree is a very ancient thing to do, and I think we are wired to talk to the trees, and we are wired to talk to the frogs and the birds. And I'm sure there is a scientific, take on that as well, whether it's good for our survival, perhaps.
perhaps, but so we look then also at spiritual teachings, how you can form that connection. So that's so the Cherokee Summer is one project, then my first year seminar is another project, and then I hope in my course on history of mysticism to also use the garden, and that is a use that we all have, I think, already wired in us, whether we are inside the classroom or inside the library or elsewhere, and that is understanding that nature heals us if we just are present to it. And so I see that space that you have created, David, as a powerful, powerful meditation space, and I think you designed it on purpose for that with the walking way, and everything is soft and curved, and you have the benches there and the bridges. And a professor of mine in graduate school told me that the big difference in terms of meditation between Westerners and Easterners is that Easterners like to sit and Westerners walk their meditation. We like to be pilgrims. We walk. And so what I would like to try out, and I have done walking meditation in my mysticism courses just to have them understand that the world of spirituality has to do with certain states of consciousness. And you can put a non-spiritual and a spiritual person in the same situation, but it's like they're in two different perceptive worlds. They see two different worlds. But to an outside observer from out of space, they seem to be in the same soup of atoms, right? And so walking, we know that we could have a health exercise person here, we know that walking is very good for us. It does something to our hormones, it does something to our breathing, it does something to our overall well-being. And to me, that well-being is the core of spirituality. To me, spirituality is about being well. Being well and being connected in a good way. Okay, and so, and I think with that definition, I can reach out to a lot of different world religions and world traditions, and it cuts across gender divides, etc. So I would like to try out and see how we can integrate walking meditations in that space as well. So, okay, thank you.
We have a few minutes left in our hour together. If you'd like to ask some questions of any of the panelists or of Mr. Davis, since he's here. Any ideas or thoughts or questions about how you might like to take this out onto campus, or how we might communicate better? As so many of you are information sharers, I think one of the next things that we would like to do is to make an interactive map so that others could explore these types of opportunities. And so maybe those of you who are information sharers could help us with that. Yes?
For David, is there any chance that the university will be labeling trees so that passersby can learn something?
We recently purchased a new GPS and GIS system, so we are in landscaping services. We want to develop a campus. We are in the process of developing a campus tree care plan, as well as a campus complete map of all the trees on campus. It's going to take some time to develop. But we'll have a virtual tour with that, as well as we want to do a virtual tour of the Cherokee Garden in and of itself. So there'll be, all that information will be out there. It's just a matter of time. For some reason, we all have plenty to do. it's interesting. It's like we need about 3 full-time students with the technology in to make these things happen. It will take time, but we're in the process of it.
Well, what about not virtual ones, but real signs?
We will label some of the trees. What we find, I visited several campuses, and what we find with tree labeling is there's some interesting challenges. There's obviously vandalism from students, but even more so is vandalism from squirrels, which are basically city rats, tree rats. They love to chew metal tags for whatever reason. There's always sort of the maintenance issue. So we will probably do that on, I'll say, a small scale, maybe 100 trees. Obviously, if we do that, there's going to be some expectation that we maintain. So we don't want to do more than what we can do. personally, I believe it's a great thing. I went to school at NC State. They've got a great arboretum down there. I think it's a great outreach and a great teaching tool. Even though we aren't a land-grant university, I think it's great to have that bit of knowledge out there. I mean, we're a teaching institution, why not? So the answer is yes, as we can make it happen.
And as Dr. Rowan pointed out, there are other learning opportunities on campus in addition to what happens in the classroom. Spark is one of those, internships on campus or another. So Andrew Collins, who's with us today, did all of the research for the campus tree plan as part of his internship. So there are lots of opportunities for students to be engaged at multiple levels and to help out. And I know that staff definitely have enough on the to-do list.
Well, look, I add a little spirituality component here. In the courtyard behind Winston Hall, there's the some trees were planted there that are very primitive trees, metasequoias and ginkgos and magnolias, and they were planted by, I guess, the first chair who came with from the old campus. And he, I don't know how spiritual it was, I never met him, but he wanted to be part of those trees, so he was cremated and had his ashes spread below each one of those trees and is now part of them. So,
wonderful.
A little interesting anecdote there.
I studied medieval mysticism quite a bit in the Christian tradition, and in the medieval monasteries, the cemetery was known for two things. One is that if you had a paramour, that's where you would meet him or her. Number two, because the cemetery was always built next to the walls that would wall in the monastery. And the second thing is that you would grow your fruit trees among the graves. And so it was also functioning as a fruit orchard. And I don't know whether the nuns and the monks thought that they would eventually end up as food for their fellow nuns and monks. I don't know. But there is a very, an old tradition going back to the Middle Ages for having your ashes be. And as you know now, and I don't know whether that's true here for the U.S. too, it might be, but when I was in Germany, I learned that we have now a lot of tree cemeteries where people can choose to have their ashes be buried next to a tree. And they're really like big tree parks, and it's beautiful. Very nice.
Do you have questions for the group or comments?
Yes. Just a general question. Has there ever been, for faculty, staff, and students, an organized walking tour of the history of campus from an ecological bent, from looking at campus as a landscape? I grew up here in Winston-Salem, came to campus some as a child, and have actually only been here professionally for 6 months. So this may have happened, and I just don't know. But I can see that that could be really beneficial. Obviously, there's interest among campus, from faculty to students, staff, that, you know, we'd like to learn more about campus's place. Should that be something we do?
I've only been here for two more months before. Any of you know if that's ever?
Not that I know of. We, like in our ecology labs, we'll go out and, you know, speak a little bit about it as we know about it from campus. But you know, no, I agree with you. It'd be a great thing to do, both from kind of local history and ecological history. And, you know, it's kind of interesting to know, like in that path between here and Rinalda Gardens, you know, why that path was there. You know, that right when you hit to the little stream on your left was a big orchard when the Reynolds put it in, and they used to run little plays, kind of panorama plays with teenagers on this little spit of land, and why they put in the lake and those sort of things. So it would be a great idea. It'd be a lot of fun to do that.
Tag your Reynolds.
Oh, it'd be like the other one.
It'd be great, I mean, just to piggyback on that, it'd be great for incoming faculty, you know, when they do all the training.
Right, and I mean, you know, I'm someone native to Winston-Salem, grew up picnics at Rinalda, and, you know, I don't know a whole lot of, and I'm a huge fan of trees, love trees, and I didn't know that some of the oldest trees in the county were on the property. That's a fantastic thing I learned today. I'm now kind of wanting to go in the woods and find them. Like, I want to know where they are. But that's something that should be shared. I mean, that's a really unique history that as we identify Wake Forest in the sense of community and place within Winston-Salem.
There's a couple good books on the Rinalda state history, but they're not ecologically oriented. You know, it's more on the Reynolds family, but you pick up little bits and pieces of it, which are kind of interesting. So,
how would we put together a tool?
PDC?
That's a great idea, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We're
going to
do it.
Okay.
I bet it's going to be, it would be very, very, very popular.
Yeah, great.
It's a great idea.
You could have a walking narrative tape, you know, you could have a little earphone on the spot.
Yeah,
that's right. I can see
that. We have time for just one last question.
Did you have a question?
It's for David or whoever. I was wondering if anyone ever thought about turning the cross-country running trails into like a little nature preserve place where people can walk and feel tranquil instead of storing mulch and whatever else is going on back there right now, which is very disturbing for me when I come back there.
It's sort of a two-fold question for me in terms of the storing of mulch. We keep getting pushed and pushed and pushed. Mm-hmm. We're really hoping for a composting facility eventually. There's this whole thing of being sustainable and reusing the wood chips that we produce, yet nobody wants them in their backyard. None of our surrounding neighbors, and nobody wants to see them in our campus. That's sort of the only place we can. So it's a tough, sort of a tough situation. But really what it boils down to, I think it's a great idea. It really boils down to manpower and money. They really, between my department and the athletic department, we do well just to keep it reasonably, and I'm saying reasonably, and that's a stretch, maintained. There's just a lot of real estate and a few people. And, you know, it's really about money, it's about manpower. So many things are money driven.
Well, thank you all for your attention. I'd really like to thank you. The map is up here. I didn't want to pass it around, so it seems a little fragile.
Right.
If you'd like to comment,
it's actually not the original map, it's a photocopy.